Hello everybody! In this video we will make a look at the potential of solar energy, one of the most flexible and fastest growing technologies available today. Solar panels or photovoltaic panels can be scaled from the size of a tablet to the size of many football fields. Photovoltaic technologies convert the energy in the sunlight into electricity using solar cells, which are devices based on semiconductor materials. Photovoltaic technologies are getting cheaper and cheaper, and its cost prices are already comparable with energy from fossil fuels in some countries. In the coming minutes, we will do a similar analysis as we did in the last two videos, but now for the solar energy potential. Let's take a look at an example of a large-scale solar energy farm. The Gujarat Solar Park in India is one of the largest combined solar farms in the world. It consists of around 84 large-scale projects that currently have a combined installed capacity of 1,000 megawatts, which is called watt peak in the solar industry. In 2015, the combined production was over 1.5 terawatt hours. This means there is an average production of 4 gigawatt hours per day, which is divided by the entire population of the Gujarat of 62.7 million people, which comes to 0.06 kilowatt hours per person per day, or 0.02 human energy units we introduced last week. Again, we can also get a figure of the energy production per watt of installed capacity. For the Gujarat Solar Park, we have to divide the 1.5 terawatt hours per year by the installed capacity. This then gives us approximately 1.5 kilowatt hours per watt peak per year. And dividing again by the hours in a year gives a capacity factor of around 0.17% or 17%, which is lower than the capacity factor of the hydroelectricity and wind energy we discussed earlier this week. So now we will work through an example of how to estimate the energy output of solar when the actual output data is not available. With solar energy, we are dependent on the sun. The efficiency of a solar module is expressed in terms of how much of the sunlight that is received on the Earth can be converted into usable electricity. Most solar modules, which are commercially available, have an efficiency nowadays between 10 up to 25%, depending on the technology used. For a working PV system, some other components are also required, which influences the output efficiency of the entire system. For this example, we will take a moderate estimation of 15% for the total PV system efficiency. The power in sunlight is expressed as watt per square meter and called solar irradiance. With data found from the NASA website for meteorology, it was found that the monthly average midday solar irradiance for May in Gujarat is approximately 800 watts per square meter. If we multiply this by the system efficiency, we find an achieved power density of 112 watts per square meter at noon. Note that this is not the average power density over an entire day. To calculate the average power density per day, we can use this map of India, which shows the average yearly solar irradiation across the country. This is a simple parameter to estimate the energy potential of a certain place on Earth. The Gujarat Solar Park is situated on the top of the west coast of India and has a very high yearly irradiance of 2,100 kilowatt hour per square meter. Using the data we found in the map and the estimated efficiency of a solar module, the estimated energy density comes to approximately 0.15 times 2,100 kilowatt hours per square meters per year, which equals to 315 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. But this is how much we can harvest per square meter of active PV module surface area. However, not the full area of a solar farm is covered by PV modules. In a solar plant, the modules are spaced according to their global location and tilt in order to avoid mutual shading. This explains why the estimated actual achieved energy density is different. With an annual generation of 1.5 terawatt hours and a total surface area of all the plants combined of approximately 2,000 hectares, the achieved energy density of the Gujarat solar park is 75 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. This comes to an achieved power density average over 24 hours of a day of 8.6 watts per square meters. Small PV systems for domestic use can have power densities ranging from even 10 to 25 watts per square meters. This makes it comparable to the parameters we found for the other technologies in this week. At the end of this week, we will make an overview of these key parameters per technology. The next thing we will take a look at is solar thermal technology. Now, the energy in sunlight is converted into heat and utilized to create warm water. This can be done on a personal rooftop scale. Let's look at a rough calculation of a flat plate rooftop solar thermal installation. Typical efficiency of these type of installations range from 60 to 80%. Let's assume the lowest efficiency of 60%. We are still at the same location in India with the same irradiance in the month May. Now the estimated achievable power density at midday becomes 800 watts per square meter times 60%, which equals 480 watts per square meters of solar thermal collector. However, the power density average over 24 hours is smaller, of course. Let's relate it back again to the energy potential of 2,100 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. The energy gain from a solar collector is 60% of 2,100, which equals 1,260 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. This equals a power density of 144 watts per square meters average over 24 hours. However, the water in the collector has a relatively low temperature, so the heat can only be used to warm up a house or other buildings. Parabolic solar concentrators like these use a large area of mirrors to concentrate the light to a very small tube. The liquid in these tubes can get hot enough to boil water. A conventional steam turbine can then be used to generate electricity, which can be used for more purposes than only heating. Concentrated solar power towers also exist since a couple of decades and are becoming more and more economically feasible without subsidies. They use the same principles as the parabolic mirrors, only a much larger scale. Some novel concentrated solar power towers use molten salt as a working liquid, which can heat up to more than 500 degrees Celsius. A very big advantage of these salts is that they can be stored and the heat can be utilized during the night to produce electricity. This makes this type of solar power more continuous and can deliver a much higher capacity factor. Another new development in solar energy in areas where unused land is scarce, but still water is available, is the use of floating PV. The installation of such a floating PV system is relatively easy compared to, for example, offshore wind. However, it is of course still more challenging than installing PV on land. In general, it can be said that the PV technology is one of the most flexible technology in terms of scalability. Although PV technology is an economically very good investment, the big disadvantage of solar is still its dependence on the weather and seasons, which results in low capacity factors. Unfortunately, also PV technology has a carbon footprint. This is caused by the fairly energy intensive processing of the silicon semiconductor material used for solar cells. According to Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, research from 2014 showed that the average carbon footprint of large-scale PV installations is about 48 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour of generated energy. Of course, this might vary and depend on the source. Although solar energy is one of the smallest contributors in sustainable energy, with an installed capacity of 227 gigawatts in 2015, it is the fastest growing energy source. A recent trend is that every 2 or 3 years, the installed capacity is doubled. Concentrated solar power only contributes about 3% of this capacity. PV and concentrated solar power are producing approximately 235 terawatt hours of electricity, which is a little more than 1% of the global electricity demand and about 4% of all renewable electricity. Expressed in our own units, if we divide it by the global population of 7.4 billion people on this planet and the days in a year, we will get 0.08 kilowatt hours per person per day, which is 3% of the amount of energy which is in the food of a typical person. I challenge you to calculate the world energy potential of solar energy in the following exercises. Don't be shocked if this is orders of magnitude larger than the world energy consumption we have nowadays.